Praise the Lord. Well, if you didn't figure out this morning that you need the Holy Ghost, you must have been sleeping. And we're going to sing, I've Got the Holy Ghost. And I know that those of us that have had it, perhaps we could take it for granted. But it's an absolute miracle. Again, you can stand with me while I'm talking if you like. It's an absolute miracle that, again, the God of all glory, which is to reside in us. That is absolutely profound. Worship Him tonight as I sing, I've Got the Holy Ghost. Just like the Bible says, I've got the Holy Ghost down in my soul. Just like the Bible says, well, I've been to the water and I've been baptized. My soul got happy and I'm satisfied. Hallelujah, Jesus. Oh, we worship you, Jesus. And we thank you for your spirit, Lord. We thank you for your great love and for your mercy, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Now, last night I was having dinner with someone who thought they knew me. Until I gave him a whole testimony. You know that long story I tell you guys all the time, right? I gave him that whole testimony. And by the time I got finished talking, she had her eye cocked. Like, really? Really? And I'm sure that we all have a story pre-Jesus that would make some folk go, really? You know, all she could do was shake her head. She was dumbfounded. She just thought I was this sweet little lovely lady, you know, and I've known her for quite a few years now. Probably about 8 years. I think I would have met her around the time when Monty was born. And she was just stunned. How can this be? And she didn't know what to say. She probably wanted to say, "You wretch," you know? Oh, but I'm glad. I'm glad that that part of me was so far from her thinking, you know, that I could ever be. That's a testimony to God. That's a testimony to God and His Spirit that we just sung about, what the power of God can do. And some of you probably say, "Sister Lil, you still a mess." Well, at least I'm not what I used to be, right? We're all still a work in progress. God is good. Worship members be saying, "He keeps me singing."
There's within my heart a melody. Jesus whispers sweet and low. Fear not, I am with thee. Peace be still in all of life's ebb and flow. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus.
Keeps me safe.
Hallelujah, Jesus. Oh, we call upon your name this night, Jesus. Truly, it's the sweetest we know, Lord. Oh, we thank you, Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Some of you are learning with each day with Jesus to trust him more. Yeah. This is a journey. And God has no problem proving himself. He's all right with that. He created us. He you know, this, you know, our skeptical ways, our doubting ways, you know, we beat those. But no, God gave us those attributes, if you will. And he has no problem with you earnestly seeking him, showing up, showing that you can count on him, showing that you can trust him. Worshiping tonight as we sing, 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus.
Trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise, just to know that saith the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. Oh, how sweet to trust in Jesus, just to trust his cleansing blood, just in simple faith to plunge me near the cleansing flood. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I prove him over and over. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust. Trust in Jesus, just from sin and self to cease. Just from Jesus simply taking life and rest and joy and peace. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust.
Hallelujah, Jesus. Oh, we thank you, Lord, for truly you have proved yourself over and over and over, Jesus. Oh, we thank you for your faithfulness, Lord. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. I think that's a good note for us to go to prayer on. Oh, how I trust him. And if you're a doubting Thomas, it's all right with God. And remember the man who needed a healing, I think for his son, or his, you know, and he said to Jesus, you know, Lord, I believe, but help thou my unbelief. God still met his need. It's all right. Don't let any of your hang-ups or any of your, the enemy's, he's a smack talker, I'll put it that way. He is. He's always bringing all these crazy negative things to our minds. You know, God's not going to answer you. You know, you're this, you're that, or whatever. Just ignore him. Just absolutely ignore him and turn your attention to Jesus. Ask your Father. We're going to continue to pray for, again, those that we've been praying for Kitty's family. That funeral, again, is Wednesday. Continue to pray for their comfort. And with family, you know, there's always family dynamics. Anybody know about family dynamics? Yeah. Absolutely. So do pray for them that everything goes smoothly. Continue to pray for Sister Teresa and for Sister Janice. Brother Hollis today. Is he here? Okay. I had to look back there on his pew to see. Pray for Brother Hollis. Sister Debbie's still out, not feeling well tonight. Did you have something, Brother? I thought I saw a hand move by the side. Any other spoken requests tonight? Lynn?
Okay. All right. Absolutely. Yes, ma'am. Okay. All right. Absolutely. All right. Do you have a need that you want to be just between you and Jesus? If you lift your hand, let's look around this room and let's take our needs to him, trusting and believing. Jesus, we thank you, Lord. We can bring our needs to you this night, Jesus. Oh, Lord, you know what every hand signifies in this place, Jesus. And we're asking that you would meet the need, oh, God, and that you would bless the Fultz family, oh, God, as they are mourning the loss of their loved one, Jesus. That you would comfort them, Father, like only you can. That you would provide for your children, oh, God, jobs and necessities of life, oh, God, and that you would minister in this place tonight. God, we're eager to hear from you, and we thank you, God, for your attention. We thank you that you find it possible to focus your attention on this place and to hear our prayers and to meet the needs of your people. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. And we ask it all in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. And we're going to sing about what we just did, which is casting all your cares upon Jesus. Worship him as we sing that.
Cast all your cares, cast all your cares upon Jesus. He is truly able, so just leave them there. Cast all your cares upon him. Cast all your cares. Cast all your cares, cast all your cares upon Jesus. He is truly able, so just leave them there. Cast all your cares upon him. Cast all your cares, oh yeah, cast all your cares. Cast all your cares, cast
Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Oh, we worship you, Lord. And we exalt your name in this place tonight, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Praise your name. Hallelujah, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Why don't you take a few moments to show each other some love tonight. All right. That's a whole lot of love you guys are showing each other. I make small talk area just until they get back to their seats. All right. Well, I just want to remind you of a few things that are on the schedule coming up. This Friday, there's a men's meeting. So if you're a male, be sure to come out for that.
The following morning, there's the men's prayer breakfast. I think you're going to see Brother Beardsley if you're planning on going, so you guys can coordinate. Woo, got 12 men going so far. All right. Well, you got more than two or three. That means God's going to be in the midst. You had something else you want to add? All right. Okay, so do be sure to let Brother Beardsley know if you're going, because I have to send an account for the breakfast. So let him know as soon as possible. Also, the Kitty's funeral will be held here on Wednesday. If you're able to come out, I tell you, people are shocked by the love that we extend. And so you may say, oh, I didn't know Kitty, or I didn't, you know what I mean? But just your showing up, it's going to matter. So if you're able to come out between 10 and the viewing is 10 to 12. And the service will start after that. So if you're able to come in for any time period at all, it matters. Your presence absolutely matters. So do come out for that. There's a sign-up sheet for food. If you're able to contribute something toward the repast, please do. And I'll be here on Tuesday between 6 and 7 if you want to bring things ahead of time. And I can store them in the fellowship hall. All righty. It is time to wait upon you for your offering. Do you have ushers tonight? Sister Penn was proud this morning that she was the first one up here. This morning. She looks at me, she goes, I'm the first. And Brother Wayne had to be Speedy Gonzalez and beat her up here tonight. No, I'm teasing. Why don't you stand with me? And I will ask the Lord to bless this offering and we'll march. Jesus, we thank you for this opportunity to give. And Lord, we ask that you would use this offering for the furtherance of your kingdom, that you would bless both the giver and the receiver in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you.
you glad for that knowledge. It's all in Him. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, for that knowledge. Yes, Lord, I thank you that we know who you are. Praise the name of Jesus. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. You may be seated. I turn your attention to the book of Numbers, chapter 14. Let me give you a little bit of context. The children of Israel have been wandering, but God has been leading them, developing them, giving them relationship, and has now directed them to enter into the promised land. So step one is that Moses sent some spies into the promised land. And so they went in, they spied out the land. They looked at everything. They found it to be everything God had promised. But in the midst of the blessing lay a challenge. Now, I'm not going to preach to you about that tonight, but there's a whole inside of every blessing lies a challenge. And the challenge was, as they found giants, big people, made them feel as if they were grasshoppers. And so the people had a bit of a problem. And so 12 spies come back. 10 of them say, we see all the blessings, but we can't see past the giants. 2 of them say, we see all the blessings, we see the giants, but God can help us handle the giants. In verse 10 of Numbers 14 is where I want to jump in. But the whole community began to talk about stoning Joshua and Caleb. Just because somebody's opposing you doesn't mean you're wrong. Can I get a witness? You got to pay attention to who's opposing you. You got to pay attention to their attitude. You got to pay attention to what's going on. Just because somebody's opposing you does not mean you're wrong. Then the glorious presence of the Lord appeared to all the Israelites at the tabernacle. So they're about to stone Joshua and Caleb, and God manifests himself in some manner or fashion. I don't know if it was the pillar of fire or the pillar of cloud or what occurred, but he manifests himself there. And the Lord says to Moses, how long will these people treat me with contempt? How long will these people treat me with contempt? Will they never believe me, even after all the miraculous signs I have done among them? Will they not believe me, even after all the miraculous signs? You got to remember, this is just in a relatively short amount of time, probably less than a year. They've seen water spread apart. They marched through on dry ground. They've seen bitter waters turn sweet. They've seen all kinds of miraculous things occur. They've seen the demonstration of the power and the might of God. So God responds and he says, verse 12, I will disown them and destroy them with a plague. Then I will make you into a nation greater and mightier than they are. I want to pause here for a moment. If you have read the story in the Pentateuch, those first 5 books of the Old Testament, you will know that next to God, the most vexed person with the people of Israel was a man by the name of Moses. Moses was a Hebrew, but he had been raised a prince. Princes don't have people argue with them. They become used to, yes, sir. Quick response. If history is correct, Moses was not only a prince in the house of Pharaoh in Egypt, but he in fact went out and became a warrior. Brought Pharaoh much wealth as he conquered a city of Ethiopia. Let me tell you something about generals. Generals, like princes, are used to hearing, yes, sir. They're used to speaking, and people respond. Moses is vexed with this people. They are a people that are stuck in a slave mentality. They are struggling. They want leeks and onions while they die a slave. If I can say it this way without offending anybody, these make stupid look smart. These people are really lacking some perception. These people are just being dense in the head. I want you to pay attention to Moses' response to what on all accounts would have been a blessing. Can you repeat that again, God? You said you will disown this people that have been vexing me. You will destroy them with a plague. And then you will keep your promise to Father Abraham and Father Isaac and Father Jacob by taking me and me alone and producing a nation greater and mightier than this group? I want you to ask yourself an honest question here tonight, Christian. How many of you would have said, show me the dotted line? How many of you would have responded and said, I'll take it. Looks like a good deal. Verse 13. But Moses objected. What will the Egyptians think when they hear about it? He asked the Lord. They know full well the power you displayed in rescuing your people from Egypt. Now, if you destroy this people, if you destroy them, the Egyptians will send a report to the inhabitants of this land who have already heard that you live among your people. They know, Lord, that you have appeared to your people face to face and that your pillar of cloud hovers over them. They know that you go before them in the pillar of cloud by day and the pillar of fire by night. Now, if you slaughter all these people with a single blow, the nations that have heard of your fame will say, the Lord was not able to bring them into the land he swore to give them, so he killed them in the wilderness. Please, Lord, prove that your power is as great as you have claimed. For you said, the Lord is slow to anger and filled with unfailing love, forgiving every kind of sin and rebellion. But he does not excuse the guilty. He lays the sins of the parents upon their children. The entire family is affected, even children in the third and fourth generations. In keeping with your magnificent, unfailing love, please pardon the sins of this people, just as you have forgiven them ever since they left Egypt. Before we go on, I want you to pause for a moment. What would your response have been? You read the text, you'll find the people are murmuring against Moses. They have vexed this man. They would have vexed any human being. But his upraising, his training, his abilities. Sister Jackie, he was sick and tired of this people. In fact, at a later point, and I can't remember in my narrative, I didn't go and check whether it had already occurred yet or not, but at a later point, he's become so vexed with the people that he costs himself the promised land because of somehow the act of striking instead of speaking to the rock to bring forth water. He's vexed by this people. Anybody have anybody in your life that vexes you? Hopefully it's not me. But we all have people in our lives that vex us. And sometimes it's people that vex us constantly. In other words, it's a story of life. And other times they come out of nowhere. What you thought were friends become enemies. What you thought were helpers become herders. What you thought were people you were close to, you suddenly find out you were feeling one thing and they were feeling another. It could be that it's not even intentional, but there's just, you know, sometimes fellow human beings are, again, not being offensive, they're just stupid. My dad has this saying. He said to me, you can't talk to stupid. It's kind of hard to get through it. It's just not being heard. And what would my response be tonight? Well, thank God that I do not feel as God felt toward you. I as I lead you as a pastor, I do not feel toward you what God felt. There is occasional brush up. There's the occasional willfulness. There's the occasional opinionated person. But luckily, I'm pretty opinionated myself, and so we all just bump along and do okay. But let's say you all rose up and said, we can't stand Steve anymore. What would my response be? If God comes down and says, they are vexing you, and so step back, Steve, and I will wipe this whole congregation out. And I'll raise up a new one. What would my response be? We as Christians need to ask this question of ourselves. And we need to ask it now. Because there are some questions that you need to have thought about the answer ahead of time, in order to make sure you make the right answer. I'm amazed at Moses. I have great respect for Moses. I'm not sure that would be the automatic response that would come out of my mouth. Now, I want you to see the power, why it's so important that we're aware of this type of question. Verse 20. Then the Lord said, I will pardon them as you have requested. The NLT translates that a little differently, and it's fine. There's nothing wrong with how they translated it, but it's a little looser. The actual Hebrew, the literal Hebrew means according to your word. In other words, Moses, based upon what you said, in verses 13 and 14 and 15 and 16 and 17 and 18 and 19. According to what you said. Not according to what I feel. Not according to what I desire to do. But according to your word. I will pardon them. I'm not telling you that every time a human being intercedes on behalf of another human being, that God will change what he plans to do. But I am here tonight to tell you that whether God changes what he planned to do or not, your word is an indicator of your spirit. And I do know my master, who came in flesh and walked upon this earth, and he spent a whole lot of time, Brother Keith, teaching. And he did these little things where he would say, you say, but I say. He had conflicts with his people. People who had preserved his word. People who had studied his word. People who had written his word. And he said, I got problems with you because you've missed what I meant. You cite to me shouldn't commit adultery, but I say to you that you shouldn't be looking after anybody lustfully. The point wasn't whether you had physical intercourse. The point was is you should be faithful to one another. Or you say you shouldn't kill, but I say to you, you shouldn't open your mouth to speak negative of another. For you have, with your tongue, killed that person. See, God was in the flesh, was going after not just the letter of the law, but the intent of the law, the spirit of the law, the attitude of the law. This episode says more about Moses than it does about God. Because I'm going to tell you something about God. I've heard God make pronouncement before and then extend mercy. Anybody heard of Jonah? Just to take one example. He said, I'm going to destroy him. Now, Jonah, you go and warn him. You go and inform him. And then God has mercy on them. Do you want mercy for your enemies?
This is a rather uncomfortable topic tonight. Oh, I know. I don't even want them spanked a little bit. I want them torqued up, man. I want them jacked up. I want them gotten. See, I'm feeling a whole lot of witness now. I wasn't earlier when I just asked, do you want mercy for your enemies? Now, once we start talking about spanking and torquing and punishing and all this other stuff, boy, we're like, oh, yeah, Jesus. Heap those coals of fire on their head. Now, I'm not here to condemn you tonight. I'm here to challenge you as a Christian. How much does the mind of Christ dwell in you? How much does his attitude and spirit define you? Though he was despised, he did not despise back. Though he was buffeted, he did not raise his hand. Though he was killed, he did not kill. In Moses' statement, we hear that God is a just God and he will not excuse the guilty. And yet, there's this other piece, this mercy, this unfailing love. And so I ask myself tonight, and I ask you along with me, how are we doing on that, dear brother or sister in Christ? When Jesus made the statement in the New Testament, love your enemy, bless those that curse you, do good to those who despitefully use you and abuse you for my sake, he made a statement in those contexts. He said, it is no big deal when you love your friends. Tina brought a friend tonight with her. That's not a big deal when you love your friend. Even bad people love their friends. Even unchristian people love their friends. Even sinners love their friends. That's no great benefit. No, the real test is when we love our enemy. When we do good to them who despitefully use us and abuse us. When we speak words of mercy. Jesus demonstrates it. He hangs upon the cross. And I know you second guess it. I know that we all put it in a special category because that was his job. That was what he was there for. He was dying for the sins of the world. But you need to understand that the humanity of God was hanging, buffeted, beaten, pierced, and dying, and spoke words of mercy. Father, forgive them. We see the same being demonstrated in the words of Stephen. I'm really searching here because I can't build too much theology on this, but I wonder what connection there is. And I literally mean this. It is a wonder. It is not something I can solidify, but I wonder what the connection between Stephen's prayer of mercy and Saul's road to Damascus was. I don't know. I literally am not equipped by the scriptures to completely explain how this works. All I have is the text that tells me, Sister Jackie, that God said, step aside, Moses, and I will wipe this people out. Gone. Don't exist anymore. And the text tells me, Moses said, Lord, they drive me as batty as they drive you. I've never had to deal with a people like this people. But Lord, would you reconsider? Would you perhaps extend to them what they do not deserve? Would you perhaps give to them what they have not earned? Would you please? Would you please? Tap into your mercy, your unfailing love. And all I know is that yes, that generation that had stood up against Joshua and Caleb, that generation without question, they did not enter into the promised land. And yes, they wandered around the wilderness, but still God did not kill them with a plague. Instead, he maintained them, he clothed them, he fed them. He stayed in their midst for the rest of their lives. You see, what God is going to ultimately do, God is going to ultimately do. And yet somehow he's empowered prayer. He's empowered my word. He's empowered it. And I don't know how it works. I don't know how to make the mechanics of it work. But I do know this much, that while I don't understand how my words impact God, I do understand that what I say is an indicator of me. And it has an impact on me. Now, some of you have an easier job with this. You just, by personality, are more peaceful. Now, you have to understand something about folks that aren't like that. We are wrong. I said it. You all can quote it to me at a later point. We are wrong. But in our gut, we are convinced there's something wrong with you for being that peaceful. Now, this isn't news to anybody, but I am a fighter. I am not a peaceful person. Nobody's shocked, right? And by the way, there's an awful lot of you that are fighters too. So I know that, and that's probably why the Lord's placed me here and allowed me to pastor here. Because when you all rumble and rattle your chainmail and your various defenses, I don't get too perturbed. Because if we need to cross swords, well, cross swords. In fact, I even have fun at it sometimes. Doesn't really ruffle my feathers too much. But you go and hassle me, and I'm not talking about just a little bit of conflict, but you go and you just hassle me. You just work me over the way Israel's worked Moses over. Oh my. I want to clean some clocks. I'm a fighter. I don't say platitudes like, well, the Lord is sovereign and he'll take care of it. The Lord is just and it's going to work out. I don't say those things. In fact, I don't like those sayings. To me, they sound like wimp out statements. It's like, give me my sword and I'll show you what the Lord can do. Now, some of you are probably sitting here going, I don't like this preacher. I understand that. I realize that, and I'm not going to give you too much more of it. But just trust me when I say to you, you need to understand that piece of me in order to understand this piece that I'm saying to you in the sermon. The Christian in me I need to make a different choice than that. In fact, the more wronged I've been, the more ready I am to go to battle, and perhaps even the length that I have gone to battle calls me then to ultimately say to the Lord, Lord, remember your mercy and your unfailing love. I don't want to say it. I don't like to say it. But there's a power in the word that I speak. It's probably tied back to being made in the image and likeness of God. It's probably tied back to the fact that we have his word living inside of us in his spirit. It's probably tied back to a number of things related to the relationship, but there is power in the words that we speak. And the Lord's rather cryptic. Sometime in the last 42 years. How's that for being specific? Sometime in the last 42 years, I faced a circumstance. And in that circumstance, somebody did me wrong. Anybody in here ever been done wrong to? Okay, just want to make sure y'all could identify with me. All right. And this was a big one. So sometime in the last 42 years, somebody did me wrong. And in the midst of that, me and God talk. Isn't it good to talk to Jesus? Isn't it awesome? Some of you, I've never known not being able to talk to Jesus. I have a privilege. Some of you, though, have a greater appreciation for what it is to talk to Jesus, because you remember the days when you couldn't talk to Jesus. You remember the days when you were on your own. Isn't it good to talk to Jesus? Come on now. It's a good thing to know how to be able to talk to Jesus. I don't care if you got a bad attitude, talk to Jesus. I don't care if you're in a funk, talk to Jesus. It doesn't matter if you're all discombobulated, talk to Jesus. The other night, one of my kids, I won't tell you which one, I made a ruling in the house about something that was going to happen. And that child looked at me and says, I hate you. Now some of you are going, huh? I looked at him, grinned, and said, I don't care. Go to bed. Because you know what? It was said in the moment. It was said in the circumstances. It was said out of lack of discipline. It was And if I told you who the child was, of all of my children, this is the last one who hates me. I know that this is the last one that hates me. Please understand, when you have a bad attitude, God's big. God's secure. So when you're pouting around, when you're just, when you got all that bad attitude stuff, talk to Jesus. He's up to it. Even if you spout off all wrong and you tell him something that you shouldn't have said and you, blah, you know, you're just vomiting out the mess. Talk to Jesus. Anybody hear me tonight? Talk to Jesus. Don't go hiding off. That's when you're in trouble, when you won't talk to Jesus. That child's going to turn out all right, and someday down the road I'll tell you who it is, and you can laugh and chuckle and go, oh my goodness, look at how well they turned out. Yeah, and they hated their father for all of about 30 seconds because he wouldn't let them do what they wanted to do. And God's much bigger parent than ever I am. So I talked to Jesus. It's a good thing. I talked to Jesus. Sometime in the last 42 years, somebody did me wrong. Did me wrong big, and I was talking to Jesus. Jesus says to me, the choices they're making have repercussions. It will cost them. Ooh, sounding pretty good, huh? Give me a high five on that one. Woo! Get them, Jesus. Know what I'm talking about? Anybody here? Come on now. Don't act like Brother Keith and I are the only ones that think that way. But then Jesus made this following statement to me. Sometime in the last 42 years. He said, but I will not be accountable to you for what I choose to do. If I have mercy, you will trust me. Now that's one thing, to submit to the voice of God. To submit to Him saying, I'm going to do what I'm going to do. And you're going to trust me that I've been just. And it's a whole nother thing for me to say to God, God, I don't know how you can do it, but Lord, have mercy on them. Because let me tell you something. Even though Moses interceded, there was still a cost. That whole generation that had taken up stones to kill Joshua and Caleb, they never saw the promised land. So even though Moses interceded and said, Lord, how about your mercy? What about your unfailing love? He did not take them into that promised land. God found another avenue. So the statement, while it saved their lives, did not make them unaccountable. But at the same time, it said a whole lot about Moses. Oh, what are you doing, Nick? Is that you? All right, give me back my microphone. He's working on something. It's all right. It says a whole lot about Moses. And tonight I'm telling you that as Christians, the church I want to pastor, the people I want to go to heaven with, I want us speaking words of mercy. And it's hard, because people can hurt you. And they can hurt you bad. They can go deep inside of you. But I trust Him. I trust Him like Jonah didn't trust Him. Jonah got an attitude, because God had mercy on the city of Nineveh. And he went out and had an attitude, sat under a tree and pouted. I know exactly how Jonah felt. That's how I want to sit under a tree and pout. But what about when God's on the warpath? What about when God is angry? Which way do your words bend? Do you get on the warpath with Him? Or do you intercede with Him? The response of the Lord to Moses is interesting to me. And again, I cannot spell out for you causality. In other words, I cannot make clear to you what exactly how it worked. In other words, that Moses stepped in. If Moses hadn't stepped in, God would have destroyed him, or would God at later point had mercy in His own. I can't tell you the mechanics of that. All I know is that the Lord responded to Moses with some very powerful words. I will pardon them. According to your word. And even in the midst of mercy, doesn't God have this magnificent ability to still hold accountable? Let's be honest with ourselves here, folks. We've all received His mercy, and yet haven't we still been held accountable for our sin? Nobody's really getting off scot-free. I don't know how He does it. Brother Owen, I don't know how he does that. I don't know how it is that he holds me accountable and yet extends to me mercy all at the same time. But the choice that I make as a Christian about the words that I speak to my Jesus are an indicator of an attitude and a spirit within me. Now, those of you that are nice and passive, there I went and I kind of gave my bias there. I said peaceful last time. Now I let out what I really think. If you're sitting there and going, oh, I'm so glad that the pastor's having a kumbaya moment. He's finally getting his spirit under control. Thank God that you don't get as upset. And when I'm upset, don't get in my way. Just leave me alone, because I don't want to hear your peaceful words, because I'm a fighter. Oh, and by the way, that's one of the reasons this is such a safe place, is because there's some fighters here that won't let anybody bully what goes on in this place. So don't take the fighters' names in vain. Let us play our part in the body as you play your part. But at the end of the day, all of us, whether we're a fighter or we're a peacemaker, do you realize that, I'm going to say one more thing. Do you realize, Regina, if you'd come, I knew it was going to be a little short tonight because this one's a little heavy. I can't preach on this one for an hour. It's just, it's too much. Maybe it's too much for me. Maybe it's too much for you. Maybe it's too much for all of us. But do you realize that you peacemakers sometimes, when you finally get ticked off, are the nasty ones? Us that rattle our sabers and bark all the time and all that kind of thing, we tend to be actually a little more genteel. When you peaceful people finally get ticked off, it's just you put up with it for so long, and then you get ticked off. That's when it gets really down. That's when blood starts gushing. So whether you're a fighter or you're a peacemaker by nature, tonight I challenge you to consider, in your relationship with one another as brothers and sisters in Christ, in your relationship with your family, in relationship with the world around you, on the job, all of the various contexts, I challenge you to ask yourself this question. At the end of the day, if God speaks of judging your enemies, what word will he hear back from you? Rather uncomfortable to consider, isn't it? What word will he hear coming out of your mouth? If he were to say to you, I will pardon according to your word, does your enemy stand a chance? Saul was wrong. He was flat out wrong. And people died for it. And one of the ones who died said, Lord Jesus, do not lay this to their charge. To put it in Moses' terms, hey Lord, remember you're a merciful God. Remember your unfailing love. Find another way through it, Jesus. Now, I came here tonight to tell you that I promise you the Apostle Paul did not get off scot-free for Stephen and all the others' murders that he had conducted. In fact, I am convinced that one of the contenders of the thorn in his flesh was not a stooped back, a hooked nose, a bald head, bad eyesight, or some sexual temptation. I'm convinced one of the contenders is also that every day his eyeballs opened, he saw the faces of those people that he had hurt, the families he had disrupted, the devastation he had wreaked. When Jesus revealed himself to him on the road to Damascus, Saul did not need to feel the judgment of God, for his actions had already produced that judgment in him. No, he needed the mercy. He needed the unfailing love of God. I am of all men chief among sinners. I kind of think Stephen sits in a similar place as Moses. They give us an example. And perhaps the reason God asked me to preach this to you is another voice. You might hear that and see that as a part of their personality, because they're a peaceful person. But you all know I'm not. You all know I'm a fighter. And it's my voice calling me and calling you, calling all of us to a place where we go, God, don't forget your mercy. Don't forget your unfailing love. Because at the end of the day, it's not just that I need mercy, and it's not just that I need unfailing love, but at the end of the day, if God can find a way to be just and still have mercy, I want him to go find the mercy. At the end of the day, even if it's not that I need the mercy, even if it's not that I need the unfailing love, even if it's not my need, even if it's totally not anything to do with that, if he can find a way to somehow have justice and mercy in perfect balance, I want my word to be a word of mercy. I want my word to be a word that reminds him of his unfailing love, of his renewed mercies every single day. And I have a feeling that there's a few of you here tonight that, like me, you might have a different personality than me, but like me, you need to hear God saying, come on now, whatever I decide to do, your word says a lot about your heart, says a lot about your attitude. It says more about whether you're letting me make you what I want you to be than it does about what I'm ultimately going to do. And I hope everybody's understood that I've not trivialized how hard it is to do this. And yet I'm in a congregation in which I'm saying to you, we can do this. We can choose to love our enemies. I didn't say we'd like it. I didn't say it would feel good. But we can choose to love our enemies. We can choose to bless those that curse us. We can choose to do good to those who despitefully use us and abuse us. Because if my enemies are pardoned according to my word, if God finds a way to use my words to determine their outcome, I want him to have the option of mercy. I'm done. Would you come and pray? Would you give God access to you right now? Jesus, we love you, Lord.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Jesus. Oh, hallelujah, Jesus. Praise your wonderful name. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Yes, Jesus. Praise your wonderful name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Oh, hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. I know there was a time in my life when I realized that I was not just a first-time victim, but a multiple victim of circumstances that had happened in my life when it would really had no control. In other words, in a desperate state where there was no answer to the wrong that had been done. And of course, if you start judging yourself about how perfect you are, you find out you haven't been. So what is the solution to the whole thing? I want you to just not pay attention to these children. They're not bothering me one iota. But the answer is Christ. And you can't take your life and compare against somebody else and say, well, they've had it worse than me, so I feel better. That don't work. And then you get jealous about somebody else that appears like they've had a lesser problem than you. That don't work. The only answer is in God, because we all need mercy. And we get mercy as we pray to God. That doesn't mean you stand for evil. Stand against evil, but extend mercy. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I heard of a story of a child growing up in the church, and the reason that they walked away from it because they were disturbed about the hypocrisy that existed in the church. I challenge you, find some place on this earth that there's no hypocrisy. Anybody found a place? The only thing about within the church is the hypocrite in the church has a chance. Because God's there. God's there. So I'm not justifying hypocrisy. And so it is. And fortunately, as Steve has told you, he'll help you as long as you make the, I want to extend mercy, but I don't know how to do that. He'll help you. He'll definitely help you. Amen. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. So what happened with, Caleb and Joshua's reward was they outlived everybody else. Then Caleb got to go into the promised land and fight giants. Whoopee. And Joshua got the chance to lead the people that were the children of the ones that died out in the wilderness. Whoopee. But they had victory. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord Jesus. If you can come out for any part. Hey, Owen, stand up. If you don't know who Owen is, hey, this... Kitty is a member of Owen's family. It's family. Some people say, well, Kitty was a member of the church. Yes, she was. She's Owen's sister-in-law. Amen. So what I'm saying is and I realize schedules and all the kind of stuff, but we are going to have a Christian funeral service at 12 noon on Wednesday. And if you can be here to be a part of it, it'll be a blessing, not only to Owen, but also to the family that have had a loss here. And you do make a difference. And you've always done that. To be able to turn out. Amen. And so if you can, and again, they're Lil was sharing with me, they're amazed that they didn't even ask. They did not ask for a repass. We just, I don't know if we even offered it or just kind of forced it on them. So, they're thrilled about it. It's just our way, right? No, it isn't our tradition. It's just our way of being able to, in the time of a loss, you realize when my mother passed away, I had hope. I'm going to see Mom again. I have a loving mother up in Glory Land. I don't expect to stop until I shake her hand. She's waiting now for me in heaven's open door. And I don't feel at home in this world anymore. And get to heaven with me. I'll sing it to you. This world is not my home. Okay, so what we want to do is extend love, compassion, atmosphere. Amen. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Praise your wonderful name. So any way you can extend yourself for our brother's family. Amen. Now, if he's our brother and they're his family, then what are they to us? Future family? Family. Okay. Amen. And I'm not putting you, you know, this congregation responds so wonderfully to people's needs that I'm just encouraging you. You do make a difference. You really do. Amen. Still remember Bernice's. Steve was short tonight, so I didn't want you to feel like you were cheated when you came out to church and he didn't preach for an hour, you know. So, I still remember her dad's funeral. 4 abreast, we didn't have this building. 4 abreast all the way to Salem Church Road to the, can you get the picture of the size of her family? 4, is that true? Remember, I thought, oh my goodness, where they're going to sit. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Made a difference to Juanita. Amen. That's her sister that's baptized in Jesus' name, filled with the Holy Ghost. Amen. Hallelujah. Let's stand and worship God. Hallelujah. Tell her little challenges. They touch one of your kids. You don't want to say mercy. Do you, Eleanor? If they touch one of your kids or your grandkids or something. See that passive woman back there? There's a ball of fire in there. They get them. Amen. Mercy. 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 Thank you, Lord Jesus. We worship you. We worship you, Lord Jesus. We magnify you, Lord. We magnify you, Lord. We worship you, Lord Jesus. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. We worship you. We magnify you, Lord. We magnify you, Lord. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. God bless you. Continue to pray for one another. And we will see you Wednesday night, if not before. You're dismissed in Jesus' name.